Welcome to George Mason University's Studio A. My name is Rick Davis, and today our guest is Jeffrey Cooper, film professor and owner and president of Cut Entertainment Group. Please welcome Jeffrey Cooper. Jeffrey, thank you for being here.
Nice to be here, Rick. Thank you.
Great.
Thank you.
So you have an interesting story, or two or three, about how you became interested in film. And I would like to take you back to your earliest engagement with film and tell us how you got hooked on this.
It all dates back probably when I was about 10 years old. I went to the movies with my folks, and we were seeing a film called Dress to Kill, mm-hmm. with Michael Caine and Angie Dickinson. And there was one scene where Angie Dickinson was going into an elevator, and she was brutally attacked and killed by Michael Caine, who actually was dressed as a woman, which was part of the plot. And I literally just ran out horrified. And then I later found out that it was actually him dressed as a woman, which I didn't know when I was watching it. And my philosophy was, my gosh, if something like that on a screen can just scare the living daylights out of me, then I want to try to do that to other people as well.
So that was a 10-year-old realization?
Yes, that was my 10-year-old realization.
I mean, most 10-year-olds run out in horror and then they stay horrified, but you said, no, I have to do that.
I was horrified, but then when it sort of like reality set in, yeah. I said, I want to make people feel that too.
And then what happened to you in Long Island one fateful day? You were telling me the story in the green room about a film that you made when you were 15 or
yeah,
seven.
Yeah, I was 15 and I was playing the lead role in this horror film that I was starring in, and I made with a gentleman who worked at NBC. And this particular scene was me being chased by the killer across Meadowbrook Parkway, which was by Jones Beach. Mm-hmm. And the scene was him chasing me armed with a butcher knife and a white ski mask. And so he's running across the parkway chasing me, and I'm jumping over the divider.
Who's stopping traffic all this time?
Nobody was. You know, we happened to just pick the right point in time when it was like empty on both ways. Mm-hmm. And the cameraman, who was behind a tree about maybe 30 yards away, couldn't be seen from any passing motorist. And what we didn't realize was that about a mile from there, a robbery was in progress. And evidently, a passing motorist saw this poor 15-year-old kid being chased by some nut job with a ski mask and a butcher knife, called it into the police, and maybe they put two and two together. And within about maybe 4 minutes, we started to hear the sound of a helicopter blade, and a police chopper landed on the parkway, 20 New York State cars and a couple Long Island mm-hmm. police cars, and a SWAT team van pulled up. And they thought it was a real incident, and it was just a wild scene.
And then when you went to show the film, this became something of a big story.
We had actually gotten written up in the paper like the next day after this whole debacle happened in certain Long Island newspapers and the New York Post and things like that. And when we were asked to show the film at the town library, the publicity department there sent out press releases to the newspapers that had written about the story. And when it had come time to show it, there was probably close to maybe like 400 to 500 people waiting online surrounding the library two or three times. Because I think the thing was is that, you know, they marketed it as if that the scene that was witnessed by a passing motorist is in the film.
Yeah.
And it was in the film, you know, what they actually saw. So
a brilliant publicity stunt, if nothing else, which you didn't know at the time.
There's no such thing as publicity. Any publicity is good publicity.
So that puts you on track to become a professional screenwriter and director, and we're fast-forwarding now many years, mm-hmm. many steps, but this film, Cut, which you mm-hmm. Wrote and directed, is that right?
Yes.
Yeah. And we actually have a clip from this, which I'd like to take a look at, and then we'll talk a little bit more about the film. Let's watch Cut.
Great.
You roll on my cue, Mary, all right?
Okay.
You all set? Roll it.
Rolling.
And action!
Ah! Joseph!
Sarah! What happened? Did you find my
eye? Yes, I found him! Oh, he was on one side of the room and his head was on another!
Oh, my God! Is he gonna be all right?
Is he gonna be all right? He doesn't have a head!
Oh,
Oh, sweet Jesus! What about Maureen?
No, she's in one of the closets. Her head was in a hatbox, her feet were in a shoebox, and the rest of her's on a hanger.
Oh. Don't you worry, honey. Everything's going to be fine.
Just
burn! 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 Burn!
That was incredible. That was more than incredible. That was amazing. Michelle, you were fantastic.
Let's take a closer look.
Wow, a real kicker there at the end. So this is a short film, right? 20-some minutes, right?
22.
Yeah, and you made it for independent distribution?
No, I actually made it as part of my thesis when
okay.
I got my Master of Fine Arts degree in Pasadena, California.
Excellent. But it has had major distribution because it's you've developed a model for how to...
We were lucky enough to, after the film was done, I had actually gotten a call from the Sci-Fi Channel. They were having Wes Craven was doing a special for Halloween of that year, and they were asking for like three, what they billed as short, shocking horror films that they could show on there. And I was lucky enough to get chosen as it to be one of the three, and so that's pretty much how the distribution of the film started. In a way, because after that aired on the Sci-Fi Channel, I was able to sell it to about 9 different international countries, where it was featured as like a bonus on feature films in the same genre.
Wow! So it now is a part of like a DVD bonus pack.
It's in a couple countries as an anthology, but mostly it's on. Like a Halloween 4 in Australia, and there's a zombie film in Germany starring Treat Williams and Joe Piscopo. And so you can, if you watch that.
I have to look that up. So how did this lead you to the creation of your company, which does something else something different, which we'll talk about?
We both produce and sell films around the world, and basically when the short film had sold, I was able to gain a network of contacts that enabled me to sell media product. And actually the first film that I sold that really helped the company was a film with Ali Sheedy. There was a feature film that I picked up at the Seattle Film Festival, and I contacted the producer and just introduced myself and was able to represent that film. And I sold that to a company called Think Film, and that did real well, and basically the sort of company took off through the connections I had made by selling my short, and I really never looked back.
So it kind of developed organically out of something you were doing.
Everything developed because of the short film.
Wild. So you're the president and owner of this company. What does being president of Cut Entertainment Group mean?
It basically is just the man who just holds pretty much every hat, whether it has to do with administration to production to sales to distribution to consulting with writers and producers on what films they should be making. And my philosophy is that I never make a film unless I know that the film is going to be distributed after it's completed. It didn't used to be like that years ago. You can make a film and then worry about distribution, but now you can't. You can't get funding unless a film has distribution. So my role has a lot to do with being in the writing stages of something all the way through. If it's, you know, completed and I'm not producing it, but I'm selling it, I then sell it.
So you're really almost like a full-service advisory person, yeah. Firm.
The FSA, full-service advisory. That's it. Sure, yeah. You can call it.
You can
that.
Have that for free.
That's yeah.
Put that next to your name, yeah. On your business card.
Jeffrey Cooper, MFA and FSA. Absolutely.
Is this a unique service? Are there other people doing this in the industry?
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of like sales agent. Mm-hmm. When I'm not producing, what I do is what's known as a sales agent, uh-huh. Or producer's representative. And yeah. Basically what we do is we act as the middle person between the distributor, whether it's Sony, Lionsgate, Warner Brothers, and the producer. So we're the person that the producer comes to when they need a film sold. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they're not aware of all of the intricacies of how the film industry works, and particularly how distribution works.
So without revealing any, you know, trade secrets or anything, are you working on commission then? Is it like an agent getting a percentage? Is that how it?
Yes, mm-hmm. Yes. And, you know, I know that many times I've been asked by, whether it's students or people in the industry, you know, should a producer pay up front to a distributor to a sales mm-hmm. agent when they're deciding who should represent their film. And the answer is absolutely no. That at no time should any producer spend money to a sales agent to get their film out there. It should only be commission-based. Mm-hmm. So I always tell people to run for the hills if that happens. Yeah. And I'm pretty stunned how so many agents are actually getting paid by producers. You know, it's they're yeah. just not aware of.
Kind of turns the incentive off in a strange way.
Yeah, it does turn it off. I mean, you know, what do I need to work for if I'm yeah. already getting paid for it? So, you know, that definitely is a major yeah. advantage to the sales agent, is to work for the commission. Mm-hmm. You know, so many, many things go into, I think, what makes a good sales agent.
Name two, if you, I mean, what's the thing that you bring that makes your company successful, makes your...
I think that the among other things, the two biggest problems with that producers need to look for, A, is to try to sign with an agent that doesn't have a lengthy contract. Mm-hmm. A lot of agents want to sign movies for like 7 to 10 years, and most of the time it's really sitting on the shelf.
Sure.
So that's a big problem. You know, our model is that we have a much less... a lengthy contract that enables the producer to leave if they're not happy mm-hmm. after a much smaller time period. You know, our philosophy is if we can't sell a movie in a certain amount of time, yeah. we don't want it. And then they can terminate the agreement.
Sounds more client friendly.
It's very yeah. producer friendly. Yeah. 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 And that goes hand in hand with the expense element, meaning that a lot of times producers give movies away to sales agents that want 7 to 10 years is because they can claim that it costs them hundreds of thousands of dollars in expenses. And they can claim it because they've had it a long time.
Yeah.
You know, well, we've made $50,000 for your film, but unfortunately, we've spent $125,000
right.
and we don't owe you anything. And they can get away with it because they've had the film for so long. So another thing is to try to find a sales agent that has very limited dollar expenses. Mm-hmm. Those are two yeah, of
that's
among the bigger things.
Terrific, and a real insight into that part of the business. One of the films that you have represented is mm-hmm. called Unaware,
mm-hmm.
and really we have a really neat clip from this film. Can you set this clip up just briefly without giving away too much?
Sure. Unaware is about a couple who just got engaged, and the gentleman's grandfather, who used to work in Roswell, New Mexico for the government, mm-hmm. has a big farm that they are going to visit that has a, you know, very nice lodgings. But along the way, the gentleman also knows that there's this secret barn that exists in the farm. And for the first time, he is now going to try to actually see what's inside. And he does find some things that are quite questionable and suspicious. And in this particular clip, it sort of expands on something that he found.
And for those in our audience who may not know, Roswell, New Mexico was the place where in the 40s or
right,
early 50s.
The alien activity spaceship was found and extraterrestrial
lots of press
life.
At the
perhaps,
time. Right. Right.
Perhaps extraterrestrial
life. So
we'll
watch this clip and look carefully at the end.
Yes.
Keys.
Fuck, I don't know. You had them.
Oh, no.
Joe?
They're in the barn. They gotta be in the barn when we fell. I tried to use it to open the fucking box. All right. I'm gonna go.
Be careful,
go get them,
Joe.
Okay?
Wait, are you gonna leave me alone?
Just wait here!
So I guess that little figure caught in the light beam there is a Roswellian.
Maybe.
Very good. It's great footage. What drew you to this? Why did you decide to take on this film? And then what have you done with it once you...
Well, the film is actually coming out on North American DVD in March.
Great.
And it's also sold to a couple international territories. The most recent was Japan. And what drew me to it was I'm a big fan of the new genre called the found footage genre, uh-huh. which is like, you know, making something sort of in real time that's shot on video. You know, part of the time I get a lot of inquiries as to what I should be making kind of thing. And a lot of times people don't have the budget to do anything, you know, of such, you know, really right. high caliber. But I think that when you shoot something that's sort of on a found footage, what's really good is that the sort of graininess and the edginess of it lends itself to a low budget. You know, you can just go around, you don't need a lot of lighting, you don't need, you know, a lot of special effects, and you could just shoot something bare bones on video that looks like it's like a homemade video, and that's exactly what it is.
Yeah.
And that sort of lends itself to the budget.
As long as the story is
exactly,
yeah.
right. And that was started, of course, by Blair Witch Project yep. and Paranormal Activity and things like that. So this is known as a found footage film, and I'm a big fan of those.
Did it come to you over the transom, or did you participate in the creation of it, or how does your
company
get involved?
No, this was a film that I found through a festival, uh-huh. in the festival circuit. And when I saw it, I just knew that there was just something about it that's in the found footage area that was going to sell.
So you exercise a judgment that's both sort of artistic but also business-oriented. So you want to balance...
It's probably more, and you'll find this interesting, from the business aspect mm-hmm. of it. You know, one of my favorite sayings is, I don't necessarily care if something is all that good aesthetically, but if it's something that I feel I can sell that's going to make some money, that's the mm-hmm. most important thing to me. Hopefully it'll have elements of both. But I think if you understand the business yeah. of what sells and something that's going to be marketable, and that's right. the key, is how to market something, how to get the people aware of it.
Finding what the right market for it.
Exactly, yeah. finding yeah. the right market. Mm-hmm. And if I can do that, aesthetics sort of takes a backseat.
Good. Let's see if our students have any questions, as I know they do. Who's the first? Yes, sir.
Is there a genre which is the easiest to sell?
Depending on the budget... The easiest genre to sell would be horror slash thriller. That's hands down. And there's actually, if I can go into a couple reasons of why that is. With a horror film, in terms of why it's so easy to sell, number one, you don't need a lot of cast, recognizable names for it to be a big hit. The star of the film is the genre. Number two, you don't need a lot of special effects or fancy explosions or anything that you would see in big budget films. And of course, the third thing in a horror film is that you can film it in one location or very limited locations. And if you have a great story, you can really do something special on a limited budget.
Great. Terrific. Other questions? Yes, ma'am.
What advice would you give to filmmakers who are looking for the right company to distribute their films?
Well, we talked about two of the things so far. Try to find a company that doesn't have a really long distribution contract. I would find a company that doesn't really have a tremendous amount of titles in their arsenal that they're selling, because if they do, the less time they'll have to try to make money for each specific film. Try to find someone who's honest, if you can. And that kind of goes hand in hand with finding someone who does the best that they can to get your film out there to the widest possible areas. And the best way to do that is to do some research on the distributor, find out the names of their films, go to websites like IMDb, and see on IMDb where those films have been distributed, how many territories they've been distributed internationally, how many territories. Something really simple is going on Amazon.com and finding out if the film's on Amazon.com. You can also Google the film from the distributor's website and find out if all of these films are in the video stores. Are they on Netflix? Are they on Hulu? You know, if these films are out there in all of those places that give the film the best chance of making money, then your film will be too.
Do your homework.
Definitely do your homework.
Great, but very specific homework. That's terrific.
Yeah.
Another question. Yes.
What advice would you give aspiring film students who want to go into the sales aspect of the industry?
I would say that, try to work at a company, which is basically like what my company does, who represents films around the world. And, what that'll do for you is that it'll put you in touch with a lot of producers, a lot of writers, a lot of directors, and you'll work for them, and they'll basically introduce you to all the distributors, and it'll introduce you to what distributors are selling what kinds of films. Kind of goes hand in hand with her question in terms of what's the best home for your film. Might not necessarily be a distributor that does all different genres. It might be a distributor that specifically does your specific genre. So that's important, and you'll be introduced to that as well. And it'll really give you an idea of all the different distributors out there. And basically, if you have that knowledge of who the buyers are and the tricks of the trade of contracts and how to, work out a distribution contract that will make money for both you and the producer, that combined with meeting all these different producers, maybe down the road you can go out on your own like I did and have a life for yourself, working in the sales and distribution aspect of the industry.
We have time for maybe one more quick question from a student. Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. I know you said that horror films are the easiest to sell, but what specifically makes movies marketable?
Cast, number one, but again, which you don't need in a horror film. But if you're doing anything other than a horror film, if you don't have recognizable cast, you're just throwing money away. I mean, it's amazing how many people send me films and they've spent $200,000 to maybe $2 to $3 million. and there's nobody in it. But I call this like the bonding concept, and producers have, filmmakers have this thing within themselves that no matter what their film is or who's in it or what it's about, if they made it, it has to be brilliant. It has to be, because they made it. But I made it. It has to be good. Well, guess what? No, it doesn't. And no, it isn't. You know, I have people calling me up saying, like, this one particular time, someone called me up and said, yeah, I just made this movie. It's about my dad. I said, well, that's fantastic. What is it about? And I'm thinking, you know, was he a former CIA agent? Is there espionage? Is there action? He says, no, it's just kind of him, like, hanging out around the house, and it's just kind of like him doing his daily activities. I said, by any chance, is your last name, like, Pacino? De Niro, maybe. He says, no, it's Yablonsky. I said, yeah, you know what? That's not really going to do it for me. So cast is one thing. Genre is another thing. Another thing that's, you know, highly marketable is if you have special effects, something like that. You know, that's the bottom line is what is it about the film that somehow is going to cause people to want to see it? Is it a twisty-turny thriller that has an amazing twist? You know, just think of something about the film that a distributor or you can use to get people aware of the film. What is it that you can use to market the film? And that's the bottom line. Those things are important.
Let me ask you a quick question with a quick answer.
Yeah.
Is your filmmaking experience, the fact that you are a writer, producer, director, is that valuable in the work that you're doing now?
Absolutely, because I think that it enabled me early on to see, you know, what was marketable. Mm-hmm. I mean, I can basically, and what I also teach in some of my classes is I dissect every genre that's out there. And I specifically go into the various marketable elements that are in those genres. And there are just some genres that even if you just have the best cast in the world, 99% of the time, you're not going to go anywhere with the film. So it definitely helped me, you know, to understand genre.
Well, Jeffrey, that's all the time we have. But thank you so much for being on Studio A today.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you very much.
This has been Studio A. I'm Rick Davis. Thanks for watching.